All right, welcome to the CEOs once again, meeting in this room, because the lighting is a little better than in the other one. You don't have access to some of the lights over there. So we're gonna open with the book of John. If you have your Bibles, we're gonna open to the book of John, chapter 14, verse 15. John chapter 14, verse 15. If somebody finds that, you can read it.
If you love me, obey my commandments.
Mm-hmm. Somebody has a different version than that? Okay, I read from the King James. It says, if you love me, keep my commandments. Mm. What about verse 21? Somebody. Verse 21, chapter 14 still, verse 21.
Those who accept my commandments and obey them are the ones who love me, and because they love me, my Father will love them, and I will love them and reveal myself to each of them.
All right, so it says, he that hath my commandments and keepeth them, he it is that loveth me. And he that loveth me shall be loved of my Father, and I will love him, and will manifest myself to him. All right? So now let's, on chapter 15, there's a, what's the part of the commandments here? It says,
chapter 14.
Yeah, but I'm going to chapter 15.
Okay.
Now, because there's one verse that relates also to them. Doing the word of God and also loving him. You remember where he was? 15. Okay. I got where it is here. Okay. Verse 10. And chapter 15. Somebody.
When you obey my commandments, you remain in my love. Mm-hmm. Just as I obey my Father's commandments. And remain in his love.
Mm. All right. If you keep my commandments, ye shall abide or live. You know, as I work to live or reside, live in my love. Even as I have kept my Father's commandment and abide in his love. What I'm trying to get you to see is that there seems to be a synonym here. Love is equal to keeping his commandments. You know, according to what we've been reading here. Verse 21, it says in chapter 14. He that hath my commandments and keepeth them, he it is that loveth me. So if you have my commandments and you keepeth them, then you're loving God. That's what he's saying there.
Right.
Verse 15 on chapter 14 says, if you love me, keep my commandments. So it's synonymous with that. You know, it goes together. It's not such thing as I love God and I'm not keeping his commandments. You know. So one thing is synonymous with the other. And what I have written in the board here is the meaning of those words. In the Hebrew, the word is natzer, or keep. And in the Greek, it's tereo. The ones that we were reading in there is tereo, that's in the Greek. And it's for the word keep. Okay, now the meaning, there's a lot of meaning to this word, keep. It means to attend to the care of, you know, something. That means to keep something. It's to guard, to reserve, or to preserve. That's all included in the meaning of the word keep. To maintain as new. Do not let something, you know, get old. To defend, to treasure, you know, to protect. All of that is included in the word keep. So that's why blessed are they that keep his testimonies. When the Bible talks like that, it's saying, you know, the way people try to keep their flesh from danger. They treasure the flesh and make sure that nothing is they're protected because, you know, if the flesh is injured, there goes the life, you know. There goes away. So that's the way you have to think of the word of God. Without it guiding your life, you have no idea who your maker is, how he thinks, how he feels, how he chooses. So based upon that, you know, that's how you have to look at scripture. So if you realize, that's why, you know, the title of my message is called The CEOs. We were made for the Logos, the Word of God. You know, the Logos means the spoken word. The word that's spoken by God and brought everything into existence, that's the Logos. And I'm reading from the book of John because the book of John is the one that introduced Jesus as the Logos. In the beginning was the Word. That's the book of John, the one that tells you that. And says the Word was with God and the Word was God. And so in all of the chapter of, as you're reading that, you got to understand in the book of John, all of the time you're referring to Jesus, He's making you remember that he is the Logos. He is the Word of God, the spoken Word of God. That's the exact meaning of it. And we were made, you and I were made to be creatures that the best we can do is to bring out the spoken Word. That's when the Word shines, you know, when it's able to find an entity that can do that. Animals are not able to do that. Animals are always communicating among each other, you know. But we, better than anything else in creation, we have the ability to enunciate and speak the Word, you know. And so we are very close to be used by God more than anything else, more than all the creatures, because we were made equipped for the Logos, because that's the meaning of the Logos, the spoken Word. So that's what we were made for, souls able to do that. And so I called Logos the CEOs, because the Logos is the Word that controls everything. And so the CEOs is the people that control everything, so I like to give that acronym to the Word. So it's the completeness economy of salubriousness. The word salubriousness is the meaning of what I call the word Jesus or Savior. Salubriousness is to make complete, to make whole, to make sure nothing lacks. So the word Logos, so you understand that you and I were made for the Word. So there are two, in the Bible there's like a, it says that we need to take care of the inner man, you know, Paul talks like that, but we need to take care of the inner man. And the inner man is the part of you that is made out of words. You have the outer man, people are familiar with the flesh. And they think what they have in their flesh is who they are. But the Bible says, as a man thinketh within himself, so is he. So it is the words that you have in you, and the maneuver your thoughts and maneuver your feelings, those are that make the person who you are. You know, and it's the care of those words inside of you that the Bible is concerned. Because the words that are inside of you are a picture of the Logos. And though the Bible tells us in Matthew that we're going to have to give an account to God, you know, for every idle word that we have spoken. You know, a word that was said in such a way that it did not, you know, express the best way of employing the word. In other words, God made us for the spoken word, which is His Son. He shares His Son. That's His treasure above all things. And so what He wants to see in us is His Son coming out in the best shape possible of expression, if you can think of that. Like people that are in this world thinking of, you know, keeping this body of flesh in good shape, that's the main goal, right? You know, they work out and everything, go to the gym to present a good body of flesh and get the admiration of everybody. Well, in the Bible, God is concerned for you to present an inner body, your inner body of words, to be able to preserve, to present it to this world in such a fashion that God is proud of the way you bring out His Son out of your lips. You understand? That's what God is looking for. So That's why when Jesus came out to preach, what would the disciples, they said they marveled because He spoke with authority. He managed the world like He was in charge of the world. People went to see that he did not teach like the Pharisees or anybody like that, you know, with trying to make people happy or he just spoke with no respect to the person. He spoke the word that we needed to be said, and whether people like it or not, He just said, you know. And He stood there firm and declaring who Himself was. He was just expressing Himself. But with such authority and with such boldness, that's what they admired. Even the people that were sent by the Sadducees and Pharisees to capture Him, the soldiers says, never a man spoke like this. They were afraid to get to Him because the way He expressed Himself, He got command of the language. He spoke with authority. And so that's the whole idea. So we need to get the Logos, the Word that is inside of us, to be so soaked into this book. This book of the law, the word law in the Bible is Torah. This book of the Torah shall not depart out of thy mouth. We need to soak our minds and our hearts so much into it that when we speak of God, we are there to speak about Him and on His behalf. We are speak as the ambassadors of God, as the oracles of God. We speak everything in behalf of Him. So when the Bible is saying that we need to take care of something, you know, we need to keep something, we need to attend to the care of the Logos, to guard the Logos that is in us, to reserve that Logos in us, to preserve it, to maintain it as new, you know, and to defend the way the Word is being explained to us, and to treasure that above all things, okay? And that's the main thing here, to make it a treasure. And to go along with that, I'm going to read the next passage here. So in the papers that I gave you, the two sheets of paper that I gave you something that says the completing enjoyment of salubriousness. And that is, I wrote the word philanthropist because the Word of God is complete. So the Word of God exists in this realm just to give all of His treasures away, to have people enjoy all that He can make for them, you know, and He enjoys that, you know. So these are passages from Psalm 119. The first verse there is verse 14. It says, I have rejoiced in the way of thy testimonies as much as in all riches. Okay? That's Psalm 119, verse 14. Then verse 57 says, thou art my portion, O Lord. I have said that I will keep thy words. Verse 58, I entreated thy favor with my whole heart. Be merciful unto me according to thy word. Verse 59, I thought on my ways and turned my feet unto thy testimonies. All different ways that he called the word of God. He called it the testimonies, statutes, you know, and even more things like that. He called it loving kindness, mercy. All of that he refers to the word of God, the Torah. But in verse 59 it says, as I thought on my ways and turned my feet unto thy testimonies. And also the way, the word way, that's in reference to the word, because remember Jesus, who is the Logos, the word of God, what did he say about himself? I am the way, the truth, and the life. So the Logos is all of that. The word is the way, the one that guides you and keeps you in a certain path. It's the truth, the one that reveals all things to you, what they are. You know, and so all of that is what the word is. So here it goes, verse 60. I made haste and delayed not to keep thy commandments. There was the same word natzer in the Hebrew there, to treasure, to maintain, to attend to the care of it. Verse 61, the bands of the wicked have robbed me, but I have not forgotten the Torah, thy law. At midnight I will arise to give thanks unto thee because of thy righteous judgment. That's another word for the word of God there, righteous judgments. Verse 63, I am a companion of all them that fear thee. That means of all people that respect the word, I keep company with them. And of them that keep thy precepts. All of that is about the word of God. Verse 64. The earth, O Lord, is full of thy mercy. Teach me thy statutes. What he's saying is the earth speaks so much about the character of God, but by reading the scriptures, I'm going to understand that. Teach me thy statutes. Thou hast dealt well with thy servant, O Lord, according unto thy word. Teach me good judgment and knowledge, for I have believed thy commandments. Before I was afflicted, I went astray, but now have I kept thy word. Thou art good and doest good. Teach me thy statutes. The proud have forged a lie against me, but I will keep thy precepts with my whole heart. Their heart is as fat as grease, but I delight in thy law. He's talking about the proud here, the people that just, you know, brag about all their accomplishments. Their heart is as fat as grease, but I delight in thy law. It is good for me that I have been afflicted, that I might learn thy statutes. Verse 72, the law of thy mouth is better unto me than thousands of gold and silver. Verse 111, thy testimonies have I kept as an heritage forever, for they are the rejoicing of my heart. Verse 127, therefore I love thy commandments above gold, yea, above fine gold. I rejoice at thy word as one that findeth great spoil. That's like finding a great treasure. Okay? But what he's saying that is because David understood, you know, Psalm 119 is the biggest song in the world. 176 verses long. And it was written by David. And it's the biggest chapter in the Bible too. You know, and it's all about the word of God. The whole Psalm 119 is all about the word of God. And so what David is expressing there, all the love that he has toward the word of God and how he wants to keep it. But the thing is, if we understand, therefore, that you and I were made for the purpose of presenting the Logos, the word that is coming out of us in the best shape possible, in the way of confessing, you know, the economy of completeness, or what is the meaning of the word of Christ, then in order to be able to do that, what do I need? Gold? Getting all the gold the world is going to make me able to bring the word out of me in the way that God approves of it is not going to make it possible. Getting all the diamonds in the world, is that going to equip the word that is in me to be able to speak boldly of the character of God? It's not going to be possible. So getting all the things in the world, if I understand my task of which God made me, will not be able to keep me to how to bring the Logos in a good fashion. Then I understand that the best thing that I can have that will enable me to have a Logos, the confessing word that is in me, to have it come in the best possible shape, to be able to be employed on behalf of my maker and say the best things about him, if I find out that the word of God, the Torah, you know, the law that was given, is the one able to do that for me, then I will treasure this. Because you understand, this is the one that can equip me to present the words that are in me in a manner in which God approves of me. So that's why to David, this word was better than any gold. Better than anything, because with gold and stuff you can get the things for the comfort of the flesh. But it's only with the Word of God that you can get the understanding of His mindset, the understanding of His heart, the understanding of His will, if you please. So that's why when this book was written, you know, in Joshua 1:8, can somebody turn to Joshua 1:8 and read it for me? Yeah. What did it tell them right there?
Joshua 1:8?
Joshua 1:8, yeah.
Okay. It says that, keep this book of the law always on your lips.
Uh-huh.
Meditate on it day and night,
so
that you may be careful to do everything written in it. Mm-hmm. Then you will be prosperous and successful.
Yeah. This book of the law shall not depart out of thy mouth, but thou shalt meditate therein day and night, that thou mayest observe to do according to all that is written therein, for then thou shalt make thy way prosperous, and then thou shalt have a good success. But in the King James it says, thou shalt make thy way prosperous. And the word way in the Bible refers to the Logos. Jesus the Logos says, I am the way. That means you're going to make the way, the Logos, you're going to make it successful. The inner man, the body of words that you have inside of you, is going to come out of you in a successful fashion. That's what it's talking about. And people refer to that, to the way of prosperity into this world, okay? You understand that you and I were made for God to dwell in us. And when God is inside of us, He doesn't need anything from the world, okay? Because He made the world. He's sustaining it by the word of His power, you know? So what He enjoys doing, He enjoys showing His compassion, His mercy, His kindness, His understanding, and He's ready to serve everybody else. That's how our characters become, you know? As we grow in Jesus, that's what we understand. So. Especially in the way that we express ourselves. You know, we are ready to give an answer to what we believe, you know, when we are asked of it. The Bible says to always study yourself to be approved unto God. You know, a servant that needs not to be ashamed in the way that you deliver his presentation. All of that tells us the Bible. So, when it says, this book of the law shall not depart out of thy mouth, but thou shalt meditate therein day and night, that thou mayest observe according to all that is written therein, for then thou shalt make thy way prosperous, and then thou shalt have good success. It's talking about the prosperity of the inner man. Okay? And I always try to explain that the word body is not just, when it says that to check your body, is not the body, could be the body of oceans. It's, the meaning of the word body is many parts working together as one. So there's the body, the student body, all things that work together in conjunction to one purpose. So this thing is that we call the body of flesh, is made out of different parts, hands, feet, foot, hands, you know, all of that, and together it's called the body. And also inside of you, all your thoughts, concepts, ideas, you know, anecdotes, everything that has given you an idea of what life is all about, that's your inner body of confession, that's the body of words that needs to come out successfully out of you. And that's exactly what Jesus came to teach us. To teach us how to express it, how to use the word that is inside of us in a manner in which He is being inside of us will be speaking. And so that's the reason why we keep those commandments. And now, to make it clear, because I said that it's in the verse that we're reading, it's very synonymous that love is keeping the commandments. And now, to make it very clear, go to the second epistle of John, and he tells you there, right there, that that's exactly what love is. Is to walk in the commandments of God, or to keep the commandments of God, that's exactly what love is. And that's agape. Okay? And so if somebody gets to, let me see, second epistle of John.
Okay. And second John.
And that's only one chapter, and there's verse 6.
It says, and this is love, that we walk in obedience to His commands, as you have heard from the beginning, His command is that you walk in love.
Oh, that's beautiful.
Isn't that clear? I mean, it's just telling you there. It's just, it's not black and white. It's telling, this is love. It's not a feeling that I have, but the fact that I walk, I live, and I keep His commandments. This is what love is. Okay? That's second epistle of John, verse 6. It says, and I'm going to read it from the King James. And this is love, that we walk after His commandments. This is the commandment, that as you love, that as you have heard from the beginning, you should walk in it. You know, in other words, John is not changing anything. He's just stating how things are. And he's making it very clear, because people tend to walk away from the fact is that the Bible says God is love. Yeah. Because you understand that the Word of God and Jesus is the Logos, and the Word is God. That's it. He says in John, right?
Right.
And the Word that made us, the Word that makes everything, that's the love of anything made. You understand? The love of that piano that is over there, or that keyboard over there. It's the manual that tells you how to take care of it. Because that's the one that tells you how to put it together. The Word of a car. You know, the love of the car is the manual that tells how the car is put together. You understand what I'm saying? So you people have to go to the manual of the car and keep those words and attend to the care of the car. So that's just common sense. If every industry, they have everything, or every product they have made, they have a patent that says exactly how the product works. And so what do? They do the meaning for that patent of that, they do the meaning of this word keep. They make a patent. That means they keep it for themselves, they preserve it, they reserve it, they make sure nobody messes with it, they right. protect it. Because they know, as long as they hold the patent of the product is being taken care of. Because the care of something is what love is all about. It's not just a feeling that says, I love something, and you don't know how to take care of it. Love is the act of taking care of the word that knows know how to take care of something. And so the Bible makes a lot of sense. You understand what I'm saying? It's perfect in sense, because it applies to all industries. You know, every corporation in America, every corporation in all the whole world, you know, they know that if the product that they're producing is going to be taken care of, that's what the love for that product is, the people that are going to apply to work with them, and they have to have a little knowledge of that, and so they're going to find out if they have at least ability to learn what they're going to teach them. So if you went to college, they understand you have enough ability to be able to, for them to train you so you will take care of the product. But just walking into a company and says, you know what, I love your products, I'm ready to work for you, then I would accept you on the basis of that. You know, they got to see that you can keep the word of the manual that they want to train you with, and then they know that you're going to love the product. Otherwise, just say, oh, I feel so good for your product, I can't even kiss it, you know. The heck with that. They're not going to hire you on the basis of the feelings that you have. Mm-hmm. They're going to hire on the basis of how committed you are to keep the word of that product.
Amen.
Because that was really love is all about. Then you know who's taking care of that. Now, in the Bible is meaning to us for us to take care of the word. You understand? You go work for a company, you're taking care of the word of that company. You're not really taking care of the product. If you go work for Toyota, you know, whether you be in the car manufacturing department, you're taking care of the manual of how to take care of that, and you're following the specifications. And then, as long as you learn that and keep on, the products will continue to be there, and after you take care of that, then all your stuff comes. What to eat, what to drink, what to wear, all of that comes because you get your paycheck. So you got to take care and attend to the care of something first, and then that takes care of you. It's what I call the books that God makes are the guide of design or guide of direction. You know, people go to a job to take care of the guide. This is not what going this way. Use this mic. The guide of design. Because, you know, there's the little book that tells you how something is designed, and so that's your guide. So what I'm trying to do is, guide of design, what does that spell? G-O-D, God.
Yeah.
Seeking first the kingdom of God, the guide of design, because you go work for a company to first seek their guide of design, and then what to eat, what to drink, and what to wear comes because you get paid. So you gotta take care of something first. The guide of the sign,
that's right.
You know, and then seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. And the word righteousness in the Bible refers to the word of God. All of the commandments are righteousness. This is in the Psalm 119.
Right.
You know, so there are right words that tell you how things are put together. That's, and you seek that first, then everything else is taken care of. So that's why every company has words for the product or the services, and you have to follow the guide of the sign or the guide of directions. You know, and then you get a salary. So you see, what the Bible says makes to be perfect sense for everything else. And the people in the world have to follow because, that without even thinking, because that is written in the very fiber of all creation. So people have no idea, but they have to follow that pattern. And as Christians, we have eyes to see that. That's what we get. We have eyes to understand how God has set up his kingdom. You know, his kingdom rule over all the earth. The way he runs everything, everybody has to follow that pattern, you know. And that's, for me, that's the fantastic thing. Being a Christian and getting into this book, he has opened my eyes to see how everything is set up. You know, and the more you get into the meaning of words, the more you understand, you know, how much of God has control over everything. You know, and so the fact is, so for everything to be working and to run anything, they have to follow this pattern. So we need to understand, so if we want to live for the purpose for which God made us, to present the logos, the confessing words that come out of us, in the way that he's proud of, then we have to listen to the word. And we have to take care of the way we put the words and the thoughts of the word inside of us. And then eventually, you know, everything comes out in place. And God takes care of everything. Because like I said, God has taken great care of me and my health, especially. You know, to have been at 358 pounds at one point, you know, and not to be less than 140 now, and maintaining it for 2 years, almost 2 years now. You know, it's like, you know what I'm saying? I did not need to get gold, I did not need to get silver, diamonds, or anything like that. And there are people that have all of that and they're still sicker than I am. There are people that have, even Warren Buffett, you know, last year I was reading that they detected a little bit of colon cancer. You know, he's got billions, you know? But this still, it doesn't escape from disease. But just following Genesis 1:29, just one single verse that I got to follow. Yeah, I am getting as close to following Genesis 1:29, and my health has improved like it never had improved before. You know, that tells you that what should be your meat, what should be your food. It's only one verse that tells you. If the more you get closer to following your diet to that, the better your health is going to get. You know, and you will need a lot of doctors. You will need so following just the scriptures and certain things has made my life way better than a lot of things that the world recommends for me to do. So that's why I know that the world can take care of everything. You know, it's taking care of my health, and better still, it's taking care of my body of words, because I'm able to understand what he wants me to do with the words that he has placed in me. And I'm glad to speak on behalf of him, because to me, the word of God makes more sense than anything else. You see, it makes like perfect sense to explain everything else, why companies have to run things this way, why they have to write a manual, you know, why everything has to follow a certain pattern. You know, every company that's going to be successful, they're going to have give birth to an idea or to a product. That's what Genesis means, the beginning of something. Then they have to think of sending out in the market. That's what Exodus means, the sending out of the people. You know, then they have to train the technicians to take care of the product. That's what Leviticus are, the people that took care of the word of God. You know, then they have to keep an inventory of all the products and all the sales. That's Numbers, the book of Numbers. And then every product that they send to the market, they send it with a little manual. That's Deuteronomy, the repetition of the law. So the Torah, the five books of the law, tell you the pattern that every company has to follow to be successful. And they do it without even thinking about it. You know, but the Bible has always said from the beginning, so even the order of the books of the Bible tell you all of that. Because after you have the Torah, after you have a product, after you're sending it on the market, you know, after you have prepared the technicians, and after you keep an inventory of things, and after you send the product, what is left for you to do? The job of keeping things complete, right? Keeping things whole, keeping things perfect. Because if the product breaks down, they're gonna bring it back to you, and you're gonna perfect it, make it complete, make it whole, make it something. And that's the meaning of the word Jesus. And that's the next book of the Bible, Joshua. He saves, he completes, he makes whole. See, even the order of the Bible, it's not there by just chance. You understand? Everything is in perfect order for a reason. That's how the economy runs. Isn't that fantastic when you think about it?
Wonderful.
You think, wow, man, the Bible is really kicking butt. And it does. That's why I enjoy the Bible that much. Because to me, it's just perfect sense, you know? And when you present it that way, then the Bible in of itself, you know, stands out. And people say, wow, man, I never saw it that way. I never saw how powerful the Torah is. I spoke to a Muslim one, you know? That he wasn't even believing in the Torah. They're supposed to believe in the Torah, right? But I explained to him the meaning of these five books, and I said, man, I didn't even realize the Torah was that powerful. The Muslim was, you know, giving credit to how powerful the meaning of the name of the Bible. This, you know, I didn't even get inside the books of the Bible. Just calling the meaning of the names of the Bible and how it runs every industry. And he was just flabbergasted by the whole idea. He had never seen it that way. You know, so I'm going to have to pay more attention to what's inside. I said, yeah. You know, and if you get to know the author, then that will be even better, I told him, you know. And I left him at that. But you can see that the Bible is a defender in of its own self, because it tells you the order of things and tells you how people have to run their industries and everything without even knowing why they have to do it that way. But because there is the author, that shows you who the author, who's the running the whole show. So that's what we have, you know.
Sacrifice holy and pleasing to God. Mm-hmm. This is your true and proper worship. Do not conform to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then you will be able to test and prove that God's will is His good, pleasing, and perfect will.
Amen. I'm going to read the King James. It says, I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that ye present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, that means set apart, set aside, acceptable unto God, which is your, and I like the way it says in the King James, your reasonable service. He's just saying, this is something that makes perfect sense. This, you know, the presenting your body for God to use it any way He wants, it's just perfect sense because you're presenting yourself to the one who made you, and the one who made you is not going to mess you up. He is the one that you need to be listening to begin with. You see? So it makes perfect sense for me to, I should, this, my Creator made me, I should listen to Him. That's perfect sense. So if I say my Creator made me, but I can go listen to somebody that did not make me, that's stupidity. You see, that's
right.
That's foolishness. But that's why the Bible says, you know, the whole world is, you know, the fool that said in his heart there is no God, because it's the fool is the person that thinks I can go listen to somebody else and my body, my life is still going to be okay. No, you're wrong. By only listening to the one that made you, your life is going to be okay because your life is Jesus.
Amen.
I am the way, the truth, and the life. I am the one that joins you with the Father. Where life is the opposite of death. Death is separation. Life is means union. So the only one that brings you back to the heart of the Father is Jesus.
That's right.
The Word of God brings you and unites you. He is the Logos that came and became flesh to put us back in that union again. We had lost that union in Adam when you know, he decided to follow the serpent, because you know that's the stupidity that they decided to follow. The devil did not make me, but by listening to his advice, I'm going to be okay. No, stupid, you're not. You know, that's never going to happen. And you know, so what God has said for not listening to His word is what has happened. The day that you will eat thereof, you will surely die. And God has kept His word, because everybody has eaten thereof has surely died. What the devil said, you shall not die, he has never kept his word, because everybody has died. Okay? So it is God who has always kept His word. So when the Bible says for us to listen to Him, that's a reasonable service. That's the only thing that makes sense. That's what the King James says. So presenting our bodies for God to use it the way He wants, it's no big deal. That's just what makes sense. To present our bodies to something else that did not make us, that's foolish and stupid. That's a real sacrifice, you see what I'm saying? Because if I present my body to God, He's going to take good care of me. You know what I'm saying? And because He made me, He knows exactly how I work and how I need to work. But if I present myself to somebody else, even to my own ideas did not create me. So if I present myself to myself, you know what's going to happen? Is I am going to destroy myself, and everybody that's following my advice, I'm going to destroy them as well, because I did not create the thing. I did not create myself to begin with, and I created anybody else. But if I present my body to this word, guess what happened? My health is going to improve, my soul is going to improve, the word inside of me is going to improve, everything is going to get better.
Amen.
You know, and so is the word of God, and we do this. And the verse 2 that he read says, and be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind. That means to be conformed to this world is to follow everybody's advice except the word of God. Because everybody wants to tell you something of how to run the life. This is what life is about. Or even they try to approve of you. In my book, you're okay. Hey, what book? I don't care about your book. You're not writing the Bible. And God, as long as I'm okay in God's Bible, that's why I'm okay. You know, so all these people try to make you acceptable in their own opinion, you know. But the heck with that. You're not supposed to be conformed to this world. That's what the world does. They want to value people's opinion. I have a group of friends that think I'm okay, so I'm okay. My mom and my daddy think I'm okay, you know. But the Bible says, if you're going to be my follower, if you're going to be my disciple, that means you're going to follow me, guess what? You know, you're going to have to love, you know. Well, the book of Luke is very strong. It says you're going to have to hate mother and father and brother and sister and even your own life. What it means is, you're going to have to hate to depend on their opinion to guide you, because your maker is the only one that has the words to guide you. Okay. It doesn't mean that you're going to hate giving any help.
You're going to hate your family.
You know, you're it just means that you're going to... It's like this. For example, I used to train the kids. It's for example, when the kids go to school, they do this all the time without even realizing. Their parents never went to school, but the kid goes to school, becomes an engineer, right? Like an electric engineer. And then guess what? The kid knows what gave him that knowledge. The books and the manuals that he read gave him that knowledge. So if the father and mother want to say something about how he should do his job, they hate to depend on their opinion. You know what I'm saying? They don't. I mean, they won't. They might chuckle along, but they really don't have to listen to them because they know they don't have anything to say, because they never went to school to begin with. But that doesn't mean the kid doesn't want to take care of them. With all he does, he takes care of them. But we will hate to depend on their opinion to guide his life as an engineer because they don't know. Mm-hmm. That's exactly what Jesus means. This, the one that can guide your life as to the way you should conduct the words and everything that is out of you, that's me, because I made you. So don't depend on anybody else to guide you for that, because I am the only one that can do that for you. But yet, because remember that that Jesus, all the disciples said, we left family and children and all of that, but still they had their family with them. In the end, Peter still had his mother-in-law who got sick. Jesus went and healed her. So it's like what they left is depending on them to be validated with his life.
Oh, okay.
That's what they left. But they still, given the whole care to take care of them, that's still the expression of God in them. That never stopped. So it's depending on somebody to validate your life and to make you be special. Depending on the approval, acceptance, and appreciation of people, that's what they leave. You only need the approval, appreciation, and acceptance of your maker, and that's all you complete you.
Okay, so because Jesus says if you put your wife and son, part of being of Jesus is loving them, caring for them, right?
You love it completely without depending on their love. In other words, what I tell people, the strongest person in the world is the person that can love everybody that is in the world without needing to be loved by any one of them. Because you found out that your source of love is this place, is this book, is this your guy. And therefore, it's just like being plugged to one source, and therefore your light, you shine. You know, like people are told that it's electricity, everywhere in the air is electricity, you know? But it's harnessed in one place, so if you're gonna bring light to the lamp, you have to plug it into one place where all the energy is coming out, and then that gives light, because not enough voltage is in all the molecules in the air. The same with us. There's a certain sensation of goodness and feeling where people say, you're okay, man, you're fine, you're everything. But when you're plugged into this word, man, you can do so much good, because you don't need to depend on anybody's opinion. Mm. You want to express who your maker is, and every opportunity is a chance for you to express it.
Right.
You know? And so that's why you live. For example, Jesus told us to live everything, but at the end, at the cross, he was taking care of his mother. He told John, take care. You are, behold your mother. Mother, behold your son. He was still taking care of his mother. So he wasn't preaching. He was preaching the truth. It's like you're there to take care. So even when you're dying, you're taking care of your family, for you're not depending on them. Mm-hmm. You see, that's what it means. That's what it means by Jesus was trying to preach. You understand?
Yeah, because I'm the father and I'm a husband, but I am assigned to take care of them.
Yes,
right?
Exactly. And you will take care of them. And that's part of what your duty to do, to express who your maker is. That's what he does.
And I'm doing the will of God by being there.
Yes, exactly.
If I turn away, then I'm not doing the will of God. Right?
And that's what a lot of cults go around, because the thing is that you got to separate. And it's not like separation from the spirit, depending on them to validate your life and to make you be acceptable. Maybe because society dictates that it should be that way, you know? And that you need to have their approval. But the thing is, you could become a great giver of do all kinds of things for your family, even if they hate you, you know? Because it's in your power to do it. And then what you're enjoying is the fact that God made you capable of taking care of them.
Right.
Because in doing that, you understand how he is and you understand his heart.
Oh, okay.
You know, it's because we're made for him, to understand his mindset.
Right.
You know, and so that's what it comes down to. You see? So, okay. So, let's close with a word of prayer.
Okay.
This is pretty good. Heavenly Father, I give you thanks for your word, and I give you thanks that we can look into it and understand your heart, Father. Prepare our hearts to have a mindset that looks unto the Father, and that we may be willing, Lord, to understand what you want us to do, Father. For you made us for yourself, Father, and our hearts are restless until we find you, Father, like St. Augustine says. So help us to thirst and hunger after your righteousness, which means just your word, Father, so we may learn to understand you, and we may be able to present to this world of darkness, Father, you know, a perfect light of who you are, Father, as you make yourself understood in our hearts, so we can declare who you are. In Jesus' name we ask, amen.
Amen.
Amen.